Hello, my name is Thomas, and I would like to present this work called Towards Adversarial Phishing Detection, which is joint work together with Kaspar Hageman, René Rydhof Hansen, and Jens Myrup Pedersen. So this work takes base in the social engineering attack called phishing, which have existed for more than two decades, and within this time frame, numerous countermeasures has been proposed to fight the problem. Particularly these solutions that are named phishing detection solutions, which seek to automate the discovery of these attacks to prevent them from reaching their victims. Recently, there have been some reports claiming that the frequency of phishing attacks remain high or even increasing, and this has been pointed out to be a little bit in contradiction with the reported results of phishing detection solutions in the academic world, where we have seen accuracies of more than 99% and false positive rates of more than or less than 1%. This was pointed out to be likely be caused by biased evaluations and the fact that some of these solutions were infeasible to deploy in a practical setting. Additionally, it was pointed out that few methods have evaluated their performance on attacks that actively seek to evade detection. So these types of attacks and the ability to handle those is what we refer to as adversary robustness. So we coin these attacks adaptive attacks, and what it means is basically that typically some detection solution would have established some kind of understanding of what phishing is and thereby create some hypothesis of what phishing can be. In reality, we don't necessarily know the true set of what phishing can be, and as there is a discrepancy between our model of what phishing is and what phishing actually is, this leaves opportunity for adversaries to explore this domain and thereby basically find attacks that are still functional while evade detection for these solutions. And it's caused by this discrepancy here that you see on the right. So when we say adversary robustness, we basically talk about to which extent does these phishing detection solutions account for these types of attacks, and to which extent have they evaluated the performance on these. So we know attacks, phishing attacks, have existed across multiple environments, particularly email and websites have been in high presence. These environments here are some common properties that we wish to define. And we define an environment that can host phishing attacks as a messaging environment for which messages within this environment can fulfill three axioms that I'll get back to in a bit. These axioms are named impersonating, inducive, and scalable. And what do we mean when you use the term messaging environment? What we refer to is basically an environment in which messages can be exchanged across some channel, using some channel across multiple senders and recipients. And a message is simply just something that can contain some content and relate to a certain sender and recipient. We derive some axioms for what phishing is, and it's based on this definition by Elmar Lachstreicher, which states that phishing is a scalable act of deception, whereby impersonation is used to obtain information from a target. So the first axiom is that a message should be impersonating, and what this refers to is simply that it should be deceiving the recipient into trusting some fake identity crafted by the sender of this message. Additionally, it should be inducive, so that when the recipient receives this message and are faced with this message, it should induce some kind of action that allows the attacker to obtain some information. And lastly, it should be scalable. And here it's important to emphasize that scalable only refers to the fact that it should be inexpensive to conduct. So thereby, definitions such as spear phishing are also included in this. So our work takes place in basically the assessment of existing, we try to assess existing work with regards to adversarial robustness. And we have selected some work which cover both influential and recent publications or methods in this regard. And we derived four common strategies used for detecting these attacks, that these solutions use to detect attacks, namely visual similarity, reverse search credibility, and channel meta information and statistical modeling. We wish to discuss these strategies and the ability to basically account for these axioms that we mentioned before, because if they are incapable of accounting for these, it could be a signal for a discrepancy between their understanding of phishing and what phishing actually is. In addition to this, we also demonstrate some simple techniques for creating perturbation that actually enable to avoid detection for some of these solutions that are contained within some of these strategies. So starting off with the first one is named visual similarity. And it simply takes base in the fact that that you develop some kind of method that can yield some similarity score in terms of visual appearance between messages, and thereby assuming that you have a set of messages which are, that are known to be benign, and you get an unknown message, incoming unknown message, and it shares visual similarity to the set of messages that you know while coming from a different source, you kind of assume that this is somebody trying to impersonate someone. So the great thing about this strategy is that it reflects very well with the axiom called impersonating, yet it is incapable of encapsulating the fact that a message should be inducive. And importantly, one thing that's important to mention here is that we kind of implicitly assume that scalable can be ticked off as a feasible axiom, as it typically strongly relates to the channel being used in a given environment. So it will be, in all of these cases that I will be examining here, it will be implicitly fulfilled. The challenge of this method is obviously that it tries to reflect human perception in a computational setting, which we know from other fields of study that this is a challenging and basically unsolved problem. And again, it suffers a little bit from this fact that it's incapable of covering all the axioms. To take a concrete example, we have examined a method called normalized compression distance, which was proposed by Chen. And basically what this method does is it tries to compare visual similarity using the intersection over union of byte compressions of screenshots of websites. So we thought to ourselves, could we create a simple attack that would break this, or break the hypothesis behind this? So our initial idea was to assume that this basically deals with byte representations of color, and they are discrete. We thought to ourselves, could we translate these screenshots into some kind of color space that represent human perception fairly well? And then within this space take small steps such that the colors will change in a discrete fashion, while from a human perception perspective they will be hard to distinguish. So we did this by translating basically these screenshots into this color space called hue, saturation, and light. And then we did small perturbations, basically adding plus minus 1%, take small 1% steps in this space, and thereby save these perturbed versions of the image. And what we see is that basically this technique is highly effective to significantly reducing these similarity scores from basically being perfectly equal in some sense to being hardly equal at all. So basically dropping going from a score to a perfect one approximately to almost zero, where zero being not similar at all. Moving on, we identified another strategy called reverse search credibility, where we see some work that takes base in basically trying to extract signatures from websites that can be fed into a search engine as a search query. And the search results from the search engine is then used to infer whether or not something is phishing or not. So basically, if you can uncover the website that you're visiting based on the extracted signature that you fed to the search engine that yielded some search results, if that exact page can be uncovered in the search results, you assume that it's not phishing, as the strategy basically just implies that search engines would not show uncredible results, which to a certain extent makes sense. But on the other hand, it's also severely challenged by the fact that we don't know what search engines actually do, and how they both in terms of how they function, but also how they change over time. So this strategy is really hard to assess, as it has a lot of uncertainty. So thereby, it's hard to get any closer than that, as it contains this huge black box component. Moving on, we have the strategy called channel meta information, which basically refers to a strategy where designers refer to only using information that are available to the channel itself. So a typical example would be this case of where people examine URLs of websites to detect whether or not stuff is phishing or not. Again, this, to some extent, we agree on the fact that this aligns with the axiom of impersonation to a certain extent. However, we don't feel it captures it completely, or can capture it to the full extent, as we believe users act as well on content of messages and the like. Additionally, it doesn't cover message content at all, so thereby, to detect whether or not a mail would be inducive or not would in our eyes be unfeasible, as we believe there's a strong connection between induciveness and the content of messages. And if you see any high predictiveness in using the strategy, it's likely to be some kind of bias and not necessarily the cause of the attack. Moving on to the last and probably most dominating strategy, which is statistical modeling, which basically takes base in this idea that given that you have a data set with some information related to messages, and you know their class in terms of them being benign or being phishing attacks or containing phishing attacks, we wish to approximate some function f of x that can basically detect these. Obviously, this strategy is highly dynamic, and it's very much the capabilities of this strategy is very much delimited by the information within the data set. So thereby, it's really hard to assess the capabilities of this, as it is so highly dynamic. So it has obviously the potential to fulfill all axioms in theory. This strategy often comes with this scenario of this trade-off where you have to pick some kind of model architecture that can either be simple or complex. And as you increase the complexity, typically the interpretability of these models selected go down. And again, these models are typically selected using purely based on empirical performance, where they assume that empirical performance would relate to some generalization to inputs, to basically unseen inputs. And just to get into a brief scope of how big these complex models are, they could be in the magnitude of multiple millions, for which one we have included named WideNet. So what we did was that we assessed WideNet, which is this really complex Siamese deep neural network that has more than 1 million parameters. And basically what it tries to do is that giving two visual representations of a website in terms of pixel intensity values, can we create some embedding that allows for us to compare the visual similarity of these two web pages. What we knew going into this is that we knew that deep neural networks are known to be vulnerable to these attacks that are referred to as adversarial examples. And this paper also assessed their vulnerability to these attacks. And they state generally what we would consider a really impressive robustness towards these, and also numbers that we deemed to be severely high compared to other research that we have seen in the past. So we basically tried to replicate their work, and we found that, as you can see in the table up here, that our replicate, the robustness that we are obtaining are much lower towards these attacks, suggesting that probably the attacks that they used throughout their evaluation were simply too weak, and we believe this is due to some undersampling. But there's more details in the paper about that. Lastly, I just want to cover some design guidelines that we have proposed, which basically take base in the, where the first one is basically that the future detection solution should be accessible so that we can basically allow for continuous evaluations, both as attacks evolve and as we get more empirical information about phishing attacks. Additionally, the attributes that you basically account to use to model what phishing is should be stated clearly, and the relationship to inferring the attack should be clear. And in this sense, if you're using statistical modeling, what would be ideal would be to use particularly these complex models that are inherently black box. It would be suitable to use these attribution methods that can help you assess the link between the output and the input, basically. And lastly, we obviously suggest that we propose that that people should be following the actions that we propose to at least lower the chances of creating this discrepancy between what phishing actually is and make sure that these actions are covered in their to the full extent. That's all for me. Thank you.